The next string matching algorithm that we will look at is the Rabin-Karp algorithm. The Rabin-Karp algorithm takes a radically different approach to matching strings. So earlier, all our string matching consisted of doing some kind of a pattern match character by character between a slice of our list, this text, and the pattern itself. And what we saw with Boyer-Moore is you can optimize this a little bit by skipping forward when you find mismatches. On the other hand, what the Rabin-Karp algorithm does is it actually converts string matching to a kind of numeric equality, to arithmetic. So it's simplest to describe when we take the alphabet to be the letters 0 to 9. So these are the digits that we use to write numbers, and clearly you can take any string over this sigma, this alphabet, and interpret it as a number in base 10, right? So if I write a string using the characters 0 to 9, I can think of it as a number in base 10. Of course, there will be a complication if there are zeros at the beginning of the string. The number will be smaller than the length of the string in some sense, but we can always take care of that by making sure that we remember the zeros. So if I now take a pattern which has m characters in it, it's equivalent to an m digit number, an m digit number in our usual sense, in our decimal notation, right? It's an m digit integer. So let us call this the number corresponding to p, so n sub p. Now similarly, if I take every string corresponding to a slice in my pattern which is of length m, it will again be an m digit number, right? So any m digit sequence of symbols over this alphabet 0 to 9 can be thought of as an m digit number. So that means that if I can scan that block, right, that slice, and derive a number nb, right, then I can just compare it numerically with the number corresponding to the pattern. I do not have to do a 1 by 1 digit by digit. So when I compare two numbers numerically, I am not doing it digit by digit. So there is a kind of arithmetic comparison which is going on, right. So that makes it much easier to do once I have converted it. So the first job is to convert it. But if I have converted it, then checking. So we earlier said that you could do a string comparison in a language like Python, which says, is this slice equal to p, right? But this definitely takes order m time, right? Because it will do it character by character. On the other hand, if I take a number and compare it to another number, then this is a numeric equality which we can assume. We have done it all the time. When we say if a is less than 7, do something, we counted those as basic operations, right? So we said that these numeric equality comparisons are just single steps. So if I have converted my string to a number, then this test for each block is actually kind of unit cost. So how do we convert a string to a number? So fortunately, this is not difficult to do. We can go left to right, and we can incrementally compute it. So for instance, if my string is 7842, then I will start with saying my number is 0, then I will take 10 times 0 plus 7, so I will get the number corresponding to the first digit. Then I will take my current number 7 times 0 plus 8, and I will get 78 corresponding to the first two digits, and so on. So from 78, I will get 780 plus 4 is 784. And then I will get 7840 plus 2 is 7842. So it is just a simple loop which says that you walk through your string and you accumulate this number by taking the current number, multiplying by 10 and adding the next digit. And of course, in Python, so this should not be this, it should be int of t of I plus j, right? So if I take the int function in Python and if I feed it a digit, it will give me the number back, right? So this is how we can do it in Python. Now, if we did this for every block from scratch, then we would spend order m time for every block. So this work of converting our string into a sequence of m digit numbers will again cost us n times m. And n times m was anyway available to us in brute force. So this pre-processing, which saves us finally by giving us a unit cost arithmetic equality check, is not giving us any saving in general, because the pre-processing is taking as much time as the computation step in a character by character thing. But fortunately, you can slide the number from one block to the next block without having to do order m work. So the idea is very simple. So if I want to go from the block starting at i minus 1 to the block starting at i, what do I need to do? Well, I have t of I minus 1 up to t of I minus 1 plus m minus 1, and then I am going to look at the next one, t of I plus m minus 1, right. So, this is my old block, and starting at t I is my new block. So, what I need to do is drop this digit and add this digit, right. I need to drop the leftmost digit, the highest digit in the previous number, multiply by 10 so that I can make space to add a new units digit. So, that is what this thing is doing here. So, you subtract the highest digit, you subtract 10 to the power m minus 1 times, again this should be int of this number, right. So, you take the digit, the pattern value at position I minus 1 and multiply it by 10 to the power m minus 1 to get that number with all zeros. Then you subtract it from the number you had computed at step n minus 1 and you will drop it. And now again you will take int of the new position and add it to the number that you have after multiplying it by 10, right. So, this step you do once for the new number. So, you remove the highest digit, add the lowest digit. So, this takes a constant number of steps per block. So, once you compute the first block in order m time, after that shifting the number as you go one character at a time through your text takes only a constant amount of effort per shift. So, this gives us this overall Python implementation of the Rabin-Karp algorithm. So, the first thing to note is that we have to do this initial setup for the pattern, we have to convert the pattern to a number, and we have to take the first block and explicitly convert it to a number using that loop, right. So, you take the number for the text and the number for the pattern, initialize them to 0 and then run through the first m positions of each and keep multiplying the current number by 10 and adding the next digit. So, this takes us order m time, right. Now, the first check is directly with these two values. So, remember that the first block we have to do in this loop of length m, and block the next block onwards we will take the existing number, drop a digit, add a digit. So, we have to handle the 0 case separately from t 1 onwards. So, t 0 we handle separately, and if we find a match at t 0 then we append 0 to our pos list. Now, from 1 onwards, right, so we range through all the other positions, what we do is we first delete the highest digit, right. So, we delete the highest digit. So, we have n of I minus 1. So, if I is equal to 1 at the moment we have n 0. So, from n 0 we delete the highest digit and then we add the digit corresponding to position I. So, now we go from n I minus 1 to n I. Once again we check whether the number we have generated is equal to the number we are searching for. Remember the pattern has already been computed once and for all as a number here, and if it is so then we increment the we add I to our list of positions, and if not we go ahead, right. So, this the important thing is that this shift takes only constant amount of time. So, this is an order n loop, right, but it takes only a constant amount of time. So, if all goes well then this will take time order m here and order n in this loop to do the calculation, which is much better than order n times m, right. So, the problem is that we have assumed so far that this arithmetic is easy to do, right. We took as a concrete example sigma to be 0, 1, 2 up to 9, the 10 digits, and did it in base 10. Now, in general our alphabet is going to have some arbitrary number of letters. For instance, if we are doing text in a normal keyboard, right, there will be approximately 70 to 80 symbols that you can type because you have the capital letters, the lowercase letters, the digits, the punctuation marks and so on. So, then if you treat this as a number, you have to think of this as a number in base k. So, this will be a base 80 number, for example, if there are 80 symbols in your alphabet. So, the units digit will hold a value between 0 and 79. The tens digit, which we call the next digit, will be between 80 and 80 squared minus 1, right, 6399, sorry. So, this becomes a problem now that we have to do this arithmetic in base k, right. We can do the arithmetic in base k, right, wherever earlier we said 10 times something plus num, 10 times num plus t of I, right. If we do something like this, I can say k times this plus t of I. If I want to remove the leading digit, I multiply by something k raised to the length minus 1. So, everything I can do using k instead of 10, but the problem is that this arithmetic will now be very large in terms of the numbers that I have to deal with. So, the cost that I have saved in going from strings to numbers by not having to do position by position is now transferred into the cost of doing this very large precision arithmetic, right? So what is the solution for this? Well, the solution is to actually not do this arithmetic explicitly and correctly, but to reduce the numbers by going to some remainder modulo a prime. So you pick a prime q and you do all your calculations modulo a prime. Now the nice thing about this modulo calculation, which you can check, is that if I want to do a sequence of things modulo, like if I want to do a plus b plus c mod q, I can do it incrementally. I can take a plus b mod q, right, and then do plus c mod q. So I can keep the numbers small incrementally as I go along. It's not that I have to compute one humongous number and then take the remainder mod q. At every stage, I can reduce the number I'm working with to number mod q. So I'll have one large number, one small number, one modulus, one large number, one small number, one modulus, and I keep going. So that's how I do calculations modulo q. So if I do this, then the situation arises that we might have, of course, two different numbers which have the same remainder modulo q. So let's go back to our decimal example. So let's assume that our alphabet is actually symbols from 0 to 9, but now I'm not doing the calculation explicitly and correctly, but I'm doing the calculations modulo some q, and the q that I've chosen is 13. So my pattern is the sequence 31415, which of course is the number 31415, and my text is this other long sequence of digits, right? And I can think of it as a humongous number, but notice that in this text actually my pattern occurs. I have 31415 somewhere in my thing. So what I will do is I will first compute for my pattern what is the remainder modulo 13. So it turns out that 31, you can divide by 13 and check for yourself that 31415 modulo 13 is 7, or you can put it into Python and use the percent operator and you will find that it is 7. So now I have to go through this and I have to check each other. I have to check what is the first 5 characters treated as a number modulo 7. I have to check what is the next 5 characters treated as a number modulo 7 and go on. So it turns out that, for example, the first 5 characters 235902 modulo 23590 modulo 7 is 8. Now if two numbers are different modulo 13, sorry, not modulo 7, modulo 13, if two numbers have different remainders when divided by 13, they must be different. There is no doubt. So this is not my pattern, this is not my pattern. So as I go down, I find a number whose remainder is the same as my pattern modulo 13. In this case, it so turns out that actually the pattern matches. But remember, I am not checking the number, I am not checking the pattern, I am only checking the remainder modulo 13. So I am only able to check that what I am seeing in my text modulo 13 is what I see in my pattern modulo 13. And the problem now comes that if I go further down and I look at this sequence 67399 and think of it as a number, this is also 7 modulo 13. So therefore, when I find a mismatch, right, I'm good. When I find a match, I may or may not be good, because it could be that because I'm collapsing. So remember, we discussed this when we looked at hashing very early on. So you're taking a large space of numbers. In this case, we're taking numbers with 5 digits. So we're taking numbers of the form 0 to 99999. And we are collapsing it into remainders modulo 13, which is 0 to 12, right? So we only have 13 values in the range and we have 1 lakh values in the domain. So obviously there are going to be collisions. So when I find a collision with the pattern I'm looking for, I have to be careful. So I get these so-called false positives, right? So I get something which reports the same remainder as my pattern, but then whenever I get that, I have to double check that in fact that number is the same. So then I have to go back. So if I'm doing arithmetic, I must calculate the actual number for that thing and check. Or if I'm doing a string match, which might be easier in this case, I just have to check that string matches, right? So if I find a mismatch, I'm done. So if that block does not have the same remainder as my pattern, I'm done. If it does have the same remainder modulo this prime as my pattern, I cannot be sure that I've actually found the pattern till I explicitly evaluate that. So this is the Rabin-Karp algorithm, the way it would work. If you extend it beyond small alphabets, you have to do some modulo arithmetic to get around the arithmetic complexity of the whole procedure. So as we saw, the pre-processing time is proportional to the length of the pattern, because we just have to convert this into an m-digit number, and if we are doing it modulo q, then it's m-digit number modulo q, right? On the other hand, we could have a lot of these collisions, right? So every time we have a collision, that is every time the block reports a remainder which is the same as my number, I have to go and check it. So I have to do a linear scan, or I have to do this order m work to convert it to a number and check numerically. Whatever it is, I have to do order m work to validate whether this positive is a false positive or a true positive. And I could cook up the numbers in such a way that these things all, or a large number of them, happen to have the same thing. So I could, for almost all the positions, end up having to do the scan, which results in a worst case of n times m. Of course, in practice, it will be very unusual that you will get such a large number of matches which have the same remainder. So one thing we have seen is that if you have a small enough sigma, like we looked at 10, right, then you can actually do this arithmetic explicitly. You don't have to go modulo. And if you do it explicitly, then we said that it reduces to order n plus m, because you do an order m pre-processing, and each shift takes me constant amount of time. So therefore, processing, updating the number and checking equality is a constant operation. So in order n steps, I can process the entire string. And I can think of n plus m as n in general, because I can always assume, we said earlier, that m is much smaller than n. The other thing is that we can be, like in hashing, we can see if we can choose a good queue, right? So by choosing the prime numbers that we are going modulo well, we could again make sure that the number of collisions is small. But there is no fixed guarantee as such, once you go to large alphabets, that you are going to actually save anything with this Rabin-Karp method.